do end up running her there, there's a good chance that when she hits six, she's going to be able to take down Lesh. Just because of the strength of Laguna Blade, it's so freaking good at bursting somebody down. The damage that you end up dealing at level one is 450. You combine that with the potentially, it depends on what you end up leveling up. It would normally be, I believe, 3 in Dragonslave, 2 in Lightstrike Array, and then 1 in the ulti. So that's going to be, what, 250 nuke plus another 160 nuke. So that's 410. So an 860 magical damage nuke. That's most of Leshrac's health pool, or any health pool at that point. So very, very cool, and I think that makes sense. Queen of Pain picked up here as well. I'm kind of curious about this one. You've got two different heroes here. Both of them could be run in the mid or in the offlane position. And it's worth noting as well, Queen of Pain can be run in that safe lane, and Lesh could be run as a support as well. So a lot of different possibilities here. I do think that probably... this is going to be a mid Lesh and potentially a Queen of Pain offlane, just because of the sort of the relative strength of those heroes. Now, it could be worth it also to try and match up the Queen of Pain with the Clockwork in lane there, and I think that she'd be able to have a really good time against him. Obviously, wouldn't be able to blink in on him ever, essentially, unless she knew she was going to be able to get the kill. But once she gets six, there's a good chance she kills Clockwork. Should be able to harass him out of lane pretty effectively with that Shadow Strike, I would imagine. But nonetheless, we might not end up seeing that in the end at all. So in terms of the other bands that we saw a Bounty Hunter band out, as well as a Shadow Demon, Viper, and a Lion. And now we have the Rubick pickup. And to me, this seems like a very strong support duo. And I think there is absolutely no problem with the Radiant running these two together in a support role, roaming around the map, making stuff happen. And already, this looks like a very, very scary mid-game. If you end up smoking up with Lina and Rubick, Clockwork sitting a little bit behind him, to potentially toss out a hook shot, that's going to kill just about everybody. And it's worth noting as well that Queen of Pain and Lesh aren't exactly the most what's the word I'm looking for? Tanky heroes. They have a not a very high HP pool. They're very high damage, low health pool heroes. Particularly if Queen of Pain ends up, like, you know, going for an Orchid as opposed to an Aghanim Scepter. And I think that we've seen more Queen of Pains recently go for an Ags. And I think a lot of the reason behind that is because you need that extra health pool. When you're getting all these early fights, running around, trying to make stuff happen around the map, you need to be able to sort of keep that stuff going. All right, so we saw the Dazzle pickup now, as well as the Anti-Mage. I think we know who's going to be playing this guy. The Dazzle, it makes sense as well. You've got, like I said, several heroes here that are all about that are all about, you know, just being able to deal out their damage and make sure that they're able to get it across. And Shallow Grave is going to be a good way to try and ensure that that happens. Now, I do have to say, I feel like it could have potentially been more worth it to ban out the Anti-Mage here. You've got Leshrac, you've got Queen of Pain, now you've also got Dazzle, three intelligence heroes with pretty large mana pools, and they can get completely shredded if they're not careful. So I don't know, the Viper ban, it makes sense. It does sort of disrupt a good amount of the stuff that they're doing. You know, you don't want to have to deal with the multiple levels of corrosive skin when you're a Lesh or your Queen of Pain, but I have to say that it's making me a little bit nervous. I think Bloodseeker is a pretty good response to this. It's a good hero in terms of the ability to potentially kill this Anti-Mage and not let him get out of control. So it's going to need to be a little bit of a gank squad. The only problem with this, really, is that I don't know if Blood's... first of all, I think that with the support duo of Rubick and Lina, they are probably, as you get towards the mid-game, going to want to run around the map and make space with the Clockwork, get kills. Now, the flip side of that is that Anti-Mage might be left a little bit alone in the jungle, and Bloodseeker might be able to track him down. The problem is that if they are not out there and you think they're out making space and you end up running in there with against an Anti-Mage as a Bloodseeker, you're going to get lifted, you're going to get Lightstrike Raid, you're going to get Laguna Bladed, and Anti-Mage is going to be farming the whole time. He's not even going to miss a step. So I think that the Bloodseeker pick is a good one, but they're going to need now another support, I'm assuming, unless Lesh ends up gain run support. They're going to need another support that can gank with the Bloodseeker, I think. potentially a Skywrath Mage could be worth it. I don't know if that's the best. It's another one with a huge mana pool. That's probably not the best one. Radiant right now trying to figure out what might be a good ban, and I think that they're probably going to end up with a support here. Lion isn't any longer in the pool, neither is Shadow Demon. You know what, I got my little backpack over here and I printed off a picture of all the heroes because I can't actually see all the heroes when I'm doing this, so let me grab it real quick, I'll be right back. Broodmother. Dire team ban. Alright, I have all of my papers, I'm ready to go. The Broodmother ban is super interesting. I would not at all have thought of that. I guess that it's another one of those heroes that because of the way that all these heroes are set up, it's a lot of single target stuff that they have, and Broodmother could potentially wreck them if they switch to Leshrac over into a support role with the Bloodseeker Saif and the Queen of Pain mid. So it's not the worst thing in the world. We see the Storm banned out here as well. It looks like they also believe that this is going to be the support duo. Now in terms of the Radiant, they're going to want a mid hero that can create a good amount of space. It wouldn't be the worst TA game in the world. Let's see, who else could potentially get thrown out there? I mean, Shadow Fiend's no longer in the pool. There's a good amount of options. I mean, they could even run something funky like a Tiny. I don't know if that's the best, actually. Huskar wouldn't be the worst. Huskar could be okay here in the mid roll. I don't know. There's a good amount of options. I think that pretty much no matter what they go for, they're going to want to go for a hero that's not going to lose mid super hard to the Queen of Pain, which is not easy to find. And then a hero that is going to be able to pretty effectively create space for this anti-mage to farm. Oh, really? Okay, so they've switched it up. They're actually going to be doing a Sand King Rubik support and keep Lina in the mid. Alright, okay. The more I think about this, I think actually I misspoke. It's not Queen of Pain that's going to be in the mid. I think it's going to be Lesh. So for a support duo now at this point, to go with this Dazzle, they could go for something greedy and go for like an Enigma in the jungle. It wouldn't be the worst Enigma. That'd be a pretty bad Enigma game, actually. Who else? You could do a CM. CM wouldn't be terrible here. Beastmaster, really? Very interesting. Okay, so that makes sense as well. You don't really have a great way to save somebody from a roar at this point. And with the Beastmaster running in that support role, which is I'm assuming where this is going to be, unless they go for a Bloodseeker jungle, which would be pretty greedy, what you're going to end up seeing is probably using that boar to harass on out the Clockwork with the Dazzle, and I think that that's a really cool option there. Alright, so taking a look at it right from the start, we've got Arteezy here who's going to be playing the Anti-Mage, we have Demon who's going to be playing the Sand King, Mindski Fangay is going to be playing the Lina, Omega Poner is going to be your Rubik, and last but not least, we've got Teyvo here who's going to be the offlane Clockwork. Meanwhile, up in the top lane, we've got Fun who's going to be playing the Dazzle, Exist is your Bloodseeker, we have Swindle Melons, who's going to be playing the Lesh. Beastmaster is actually going to be running this offlane position with Zai. And last but not least, we got Couch Potato on this Queen of Pain. So very, very interesting start here. I'm wondering... this is funky. This is going to be really funky. Is this going to be a duo offlane? Very, very interesting there. All right, so we do see this camp that's going to get blocked along with a decent amount of vision by Zai, and they're going to be waiting to see if they can end up catching anybody here in this area. So Lesh has gone for the null tally, two tangos. We've also got the same thing out of the Queen of Pain. Maybe Zai is going to end up going on over the top lane, but it's very, very strange. I'm not sure exactly what he's doing. They do spot Arteezy right over here, and they spot the Lesh on the other side of the river. Might end up trying to go for this rune here, but no, seeing the Beastmaster, they're going to back on out, I do assume. Up in the top lane, though, a little bit of back and forth, able to get the first blood there. Goodness gracious, Lina kills the Bloodseeker, and that's not how you want to start this at all. So it is going to be a duo lane here of the Queen of Pain as well as the Beastmaster. So very, very interested to see how this turns out. I think that there's a lot of potential here. And I guess that they just want to be able to really pressure the Anti-Mage here without committing too much to it in a full aggressive tri-lane. All right, let's see. Omega Poner now is sitting here with the Dazzle nearby as well. He could opt to move on in and try and help out the Lesh if things get a little bit too dicey. But this little combo here is going to be pretty strong. But yeah, I think that Peasy is ever so slightly upset about the fact that we've got a duo offlane. It's very, very funky. Is able to dodge the blink or the shadow strike there as well. Very well done. Not exactly what you want out of your out of the first shadow strike that you throw out at the beginning of the game. But yeah, Zai here is going to be having absolutely no trouble just continuing to walk away from this. With that stout shield, he's going to be able to tank creeps a little bit effectively. And so the aggressive duo lane, you've got Clockwork up here in the off lane, is going to have to be zoned out by a combination of the Dazzle as well as the Bloodseeker. And I think that this makes sense now. So you're going to end up being able to have another support who's going to be able to, well, not necessarily complete support. He is going to be in a decent amount of EXP. Yeah, you know what? This makes sense. All right, let me sort of parse this out because I'm having a little bit of trouble putting my words together with what I'm trying to say. So I think that this makes a lot of sense. You needed somebody who's going to be able to roam with the Beastmaster to get a kill on the Anti-Mage. And the somebody to roam with the Bloodseeker, I should say, to get a kill with on the Anti-Mage. And I think that the roar coming out from the Beastmaster is going to be able to accomplish that really, really effectively. And the other side of that is that you needed that support to ensure that he was able to get levels. And how do you do that? You put him in a support duo offlane, get him the levels he needs, get Bloodseeker the levels he needs, and then they're going to be able to rotate on in and potentially get a kill on this Anti-Mage as he gets towards that mid-game, hopefully before he gets his Battle Fury. So very, very cool. I like this setup of the lanes out of the Dire team. And the other thing about this as well is that you have the potential for this Quap to roam around a little bit, disrupt the jungle, make sure that Sand King isn't going to be able to stack up these camps and eventually get that early Blink Dagger, all the while getting more and more levels on this Beastmaster. Very, very, very cool. I like this a whole lot. Looks like he's going to be dropping his Quelling Blade just to ensure that he gets the right amount of aggro on creeps. Unfortunately, wasn't quite able to catch that one. A little bit of back and forth here. Do not want to get caught out by the combination of the Rubick and the Sand King. And as you see, the Rubick is going to have to sit a little bit more close to home at this point, considering the fact that they're getting aggressively duo lane. So a little bit of just harassment there, making their lives a little bit tougher. And it's working out a little bit. You know, you've got Beastmaster with 7 last hits. You've got Queen of Pain with 3. So between the two of them, they've got 10 and 14 on Arteezy. Meanwhile, up in the top lane, you've got this Beastmaster who's been able to get a comfortable 19 and 2. So really, really solid there. Clockwork continuing to just sort of deny him as much EXP as he possibly can, as well as pushing him back, getting him a little bit less mana, all those fun little things as well. Queen of Pain ends up pausing the game. Not sure exactly what's going on there. But let's take a look at team net worth at this point. We have it really, really even. Obviously, everything under 500 in terms of EXP. It's looking a little bit more into the favor of the Radiant. And I think that a large part of the reason for this is because if you end up looking at the levels, the Queen of Pain is getting a little bit under-leveled here at this point. It is worth noting that also the Rubick and the Sand King are a little bit less as well. So we'll see how she ends up doing. I think the big thing is as long as she gets 6 going into the mid game and is able to make something happen with that Sonic Wave, I think they're going to be okay. Because that's going to be, Dazzle ends up getting the kill on the Clockwork. Very nicely done. Sorry about missing that kill there. But I think that, you know, there's this sort of period in between where Queen of Pain deals a whole ton of damage with her ulti. And until she gets to 11, like, there's not really a huge difference between, there's not a huge difference between 6 and 8, for instance. You do get a little bit of extra damage on several of the other heroes. Zai, it might end up going down here. Needs to be careful. Bro Strike comes down, as well as the lift. A second going to go, and he is going to end up getting taken out by that sinking. But what I was talking about, oh, a little bit of rotation, wanted to potentially get something there, not able to do it. And meanwhile, the Clockwork was able to kill the Queen of Pain off the back of a failed gank attempt, unfortunately. So well done there by the Radiant to pull it back into their favor a little bit more effectively. But what I was saying is that in terms of the Queen of Pain's damage, like obviously you're going to get more and more points in the Scream of Pain as well as Shadow Strike and get extra damage that way. But the damage from the, oh, Swindle Melons gets the kill there, very nicely done. Clockwork gonna try and slow him down a little bit, but with the Dazzle here, gonna be absolutely no problem. Poison Touch goes out as well. What I was saying though is that, you know, she's going to be able to toss out a Sonic Wave in the middle of a team fight as we get towards this mid game, and it's not going to be a huge problem. The big thing that she just needs to make sure she gets is, you know, by the, for instance, 11 minute mark, let's say, she needs to be able to get her to level 6. So might even be able to steal a lot of these stacks here. It looks like Demon is going to end up, oh, he needs to be careful, really does not want to get Burrow Striked at this point. And yeah, she needs to be super duper careful, is going to be able to continue to sort of steal EXP. We're going to see a Wild Axes come out from the Beastmaster. Nicely done, catches the Sand King on the back side of it. Man, oh man, is he terrified. Really doesn't want to end up getting caught here. There he is though. Boar goes down for the slow as well. We've got two boards coming on out. There is the Sandstorm yet again. Has Wild Axes in another second, but no mana to cast it, unfortunately. Might try and see if they can go on in with the Shadow Wave to heal on up the boar, but no, they're going to have to back on out at this point. So a little bit of wasted time there on both sides. No big deal, but, you know, it's something that's worth noting. It's looking... very, very back and forth so far. I think that Radiant is still a little bit ahead. The mid lane and the safe lane are the big things that are keeping the Dire sort of even with them. But the problem is that this off lane really hasn't been able to get as much, and you might want a little bit more out of the Queen of Pain. But you're able to run four cores somewhat effectively. And the Queen of Pain isn't terribly underleveled. Also worth noting that the Sand King is going straight for Boots and then a Blink Dagger afterwards. Three heroes over here, might be able to catch this Rubick. Lift goes down, isn't going to be able to stun any of them, unfortunately. We do have the Anti-Mage over here who has Mana Void as well, might opt to use it in a second. Blinks on in, is able to catch another Mana Break. Mana Void might be able to get the kill, but with the Wand, that's going to keep him alive. Demon comes on in, again, Shallow Grave, nicely done. Split Earth misses, unfortunately. Tosses out this Lightning Storm, catches three. This is going to be pretty good here. Pulse Nova down as well, he doesn't have enough mana to sustain though. Four heroes here for the Dire. They're not going to be able to get any kills, it doesn't look like. We do have the Bloodseeker rotating on in. All of them are so low. He is going to be a race car coming on in, trying to get a kill. Look how fast he's going. He's going to be able to take out all of these heroes, I do believe. One more hit. Well done. The Lina was pretty solid, and now we might see the Anti-Mage go down as well. Bloodseeker smells blood. Oh my god, Mana Void for the win. Very nicely done. And are they going to be able to get the kill on the backside? Don't know. Shadow Wave, yes. Well done. So four heroes there, able to trade the Lina and the Anti-Mage for the Bloodseeker. Honestly, I think that that was very, very well done. The only problem here was that you did see the Anti-Mage get a decent amount from that kill on the Bloodseeker because he was top of the net worth there. So a fairly even change. I think that that helped out the other heroes on the Dire to catch up a little bit more, but the Anti-Mage now is at the top of the net worth for the Radiant. And the Midas picked up. That's going to help. That's really going to help a lot. So very well done there. Let's see what other items we have. Trying to hit. Oh my god, they almost got the kill there on the Clockwork. I didn't even realize. Swindle needs to be careful here. We've got the Lina in the area. Does have Laguna Blade in just a couple more seconds. Catches the Lightstrike Array. Nicely done. Only 10 more. Yes, Fade Bolt ends up getting the kill there, and that's really big. Very nicely done. Lina ends up shooting on up to second in terms of net worth, and now you've got the Anti-Mage up there as well. The only thing is that this Bloodseeker does have the Hand of Midas, so need to be careful here. We also have the Clockwork who's going to be up in this top lane as well. So we'll see what the other items end up being. Able to take down that that Sand King as well. Very nicely done there. I think that Roar was used. Is that correct? Yes, Roar was used to be able to secure that kill. So well done there. Does have Mana Void if he wanted to use it, but the Beastmaster doesn't have the largest mana pool in the world. It's worth noting. I almost feel like it might have potentially been more worth it to try and kill the Anti-Mage again with that roar, but it is going to further delay the blink timing of that Sand King. We've got Clockwork coming on in, does have Hookshot. If he needs to use it, is he going to be able to scout this out? The boar trying to block it desperately. Very well done there on the body blocks. We do have Lena who's going to be able to come on in here. Lesh gets the kill on the Rubick as well. Lightstrike right down. One more hit is going to be able to take him down with the Mana Void, but now the Anti-Mage is ruptured as well. He's going to go down. Oh my goodness. So three heroes dead. The top two net worth for the Radiant as well as a casual Rubick are all going to go down for the cost of a Lesh. And meanwhile, while this is all going on, Bloodseeker is going to be able to do pretty much whatever the heck he wants. He's going to be down here in the bottom lane, actually, and they're going to be able to take this tower, I think. Off the top of that, you had the Dazzle, who's going to be able to deal a decent amount of damage to the top tower as well. So really, really solid play here out of the Dire to be able to bring it back into their favor yet again. And we'll see if they're going to be able to continue to sort of build this lead and go from there. Waiting for that last hit on the tower is going to be able to get it very nicely down there. Oh, Clockwork almost got taken out there. That was really close. Very fortunately was able to hook away from the rest of the Dire that were in the jungle and get on over to that creep camp. So Bloodseeker now picking up his treads as well. We do have the Anti-Mage still a little ways away from picking up the Battle Fury. Looks like he actually might be going for Vlad's first. With all of these people over here, oh god, Swindle's gonna end up going down, I think. Is he getting away from this? Are you kidding me? He's turning around. He doesn't care, but Laguna Blade ends up getting used in the end. Wanted to make sure that the Bloodseeker was gonna be able to run cleanup crew, not able to get over to the Sand King in time, unfortunately. So the Ring of Regen was picked up. I guess that this was probably Anti-Mage wanting to buy out at the last second right before he ended up going down. That makes a decent amount of sense. And now we've got Couch Potato here who does have six and is going to be able to be effective in these team fights like I was talking about. And I think that this is going to be a really big moment here is how are they going to be able to use in combination the the Sonic Wave as well as the Primal Roar coming out from the Beastmaster. I think that that's going to be really, really important. And we'll see. I think that there's a lot of potential there to really gank and continue to disrupt this Anti-Mage's farm. Because right now, he still doesn't have his Battle Fury. He's about, 2,100 gold away from finishing off. He's a little ways away from it. They have this opportunity here to continue to deny him gold. And I think that if they're able to do that at least one more time, they're going to put themselves in a really strong position to potentially win here. Excuse me about that while I cough. Oh my goodness gracious. Four heroes here mid. Excuse me, all five of them because Anti-Mage is on the other side. Clockwork hooks on in, but then thinks the better of it and decides to walk away. Roar goes down on Lena. She is super dead. Unfortunately, Sonic Wave only catches one, and the Roar only caught one as well. So not really the most value out of those spells. They are probably going to be able to secure the tower off the back of this, but I almost feel like it's a bit of a wasted opportunity, potentially. I mean, because now, so you've got the Anti-Mage who's going to be up here again, farming out your jungle while you're taking down this tower. Imagine if they would have been able to potentially catch him. I mean, I guess you do have to sort of try and catch the Lina out of position, but no big deal. I think it's going to be fine. I'm probably overreacting ever so slightly. No glyph used, by the way. They might have already used it, but I'm not sure. All right, Lightning Storm down now as well. We're going to see Swindle continue to try and push this lane out a little bit. Do they have any dust? Oh my god, Split Earth goes down. He's going to try and Burrow Strike away as quickly as possible. Anti-Mage is just going to keep farming for as long as humanly possible, or as long as anti-magingly possible. And now you've got Gank Squad coming on in. If he's able to land Rupture here, this might be a dead Anti-Mage. Does have a TP scroll is the only thing, so they need another hero here to ensure that they're able to interrupt this TP. No, he's going to be out of there. He knows what's going down. All right, so Gank Squad failed ever so slightly. They're going to have to try and farm out the jungle now. A little bit of lack of coordination, it feels like, almost. Out of the Dire, they sort of have the same idea, but it's not completely going the way that they want it to, unfortunately. Exist now is going to be able to mind us up creeps as well and build into whatever next item he wants. Curious if we might end up seeing Blade Mail. Wouldn't be the worst option in the world. Potentially Radiance as well. They do have a Blink Dagger on Sand King now. He also has level 7. So if he wants to, and this is the thing, they're sort of allowing these timings to come back in. And now I feel like the Dire kind of needs to hold off on having a team fight until they build back up the advantage again. And this is probably going to happen with the next item. item that Bloodseeker ends up picking up. You also have several other items that you might be waiting for on these other heroes. We're going to be seeing a Necronomicon out of Beastmaster relatively shortly. Only needs about, 900 more gold to finish that off. There's a couple items away that they're fairly close to at this point. Looks like Lesh is also going to be going for drums relatively shortly. They might be able to take this tower here, though, and it looks like, I don't think they want to force this issue, honestly. Oh my god, Roar goes down there, able to catch the Lina. We also have Clockwork Cogs now. They're all going to end up getting silenced here by the Bloodseeker. He's rotating on in. Sonic Wave down, able to take down the Rubick almost immediately. Epicenter, though, is pretty good. Queen of Pain does end up going down. Anti-Mage is now here to party and might be able to catch and kill. Rupture goes down. Very, very well done. And now Swindle's going to be able to kill this Anti-Mage here, I do believe. Oh my god, Vanna Void comes out last second. Exist is going to be able to dodge that Burrow Strike as well. So Lesh took down Lina also off the back of that with the Diabolic Edict. And now we see the Dazzle end up going down as well to the Clockwork. So these heroes relatively low, but don't think that they're going to be able to get taken out by this Bloodseeker. Taking a look at that fight recap, it's kind of okay because you did end up mainly feeding that gold to the Sand King, which isn't the biggest issue in the world. And Anti-Mage lost a decent amount of gold there. The problem is that you also lost several of your cores, so it wasn't as bad as it could have been. And it looks like they're going to be able to take this tower for free as well. Apparently they don't want to deny, so all right. I guess, why not? So it wasn't as bad as it could have been. The gold graph is going to look pretty bad. It's going to rotate shooting on back up into the favor of the Radiant. Shadowblade, interesting. Okay, so Dire now has about a 500 EXP lead. In terms of gold, it's still pretty high up there. And this is the thing that I'm talking about, is that, you know, first of all, the Midas is going to be able to propel this Bloodseeker on up further and get him more items. Lina ends up taking out the Beastmaster, getting a little bit fresh with her, apparently. That Shadowblade really paying off. But the problem that you're going to end up seeing is that the thing that the Dire is doing really, really well here is continuing to shut down this Anti-Mage. Still doesn't have his Battle Fury, and the sort of delaying that as long as you possibly can is going to mean it's going to be that much longer before he really comes online. And then after he gets his Battle Fury, even you can still fight. You can rotate on in through the jungle. The Shadow Blade pickup here by the Bloodseeker is actually incredibly smart, now that I'm thinking about it a second time, because Rubick able to get the kill there on the Dazzle, unfortunately. So more heroes getting picked off. This is a little bit sloppy here. Celeste, couple minutes have been a little bit sloppy for the Dire, but picking up the Shadow Blade there is going to mean that he's going to be able to rotate on into the jungle and just continue to try and deny this Anti-Mage's farm. He does have his Battle Fury now, so they really need to make it happen within the next little bit here. Dazzle getting picked off isn't the best, but they do still have Roar on the Beastmaster when Bloodseeker ends up trying to go on through with them. I think that they're going to need to smoke up through the jungle to make it happen. And as you can see here, Bloodseeker already rotating on down to this bot lane. We do have these other two heroes smoked up as well. And yeah, this is what we're going to end up seeing. They're all going to rotate through this jungle, try and catch him. But as we're talking about this, the Anti-Mage is heading away. He's over in the mid lane. No tower here mid as well. Means that they're hunting. Like, this is what they're trying to do at this point. And maybe they might even be able to get a kill without the Bloodseeker. Smoke is about to run out. Unfortunate. I don't know if they're going to be able to get it. Might content themselves to simply go for the Sand King. Not the best kill in the world, but it's going to help. Every little bit helps. Unfortunately, he already had his Blink Dagger. So it is going to deny them their form of initiation, and it's going to mean that they can probably push down this tower. Still not exactly what they would want. They really want to take down this Anti-Mage, if at all possible. But not looking like that's going to be able to be the case. We do have several more people rotating on in, trying to get a kill off on this Rubick. This Queen of Pain is playing a little bit of a less farmed version of her, which is pretty cool to see, actually. You sort of go for the value level 6, you get some more levels every now and then. She is going deep for this, is going to be able to take on down this Anti-Mage potential here as well. Does have his TP scroll, but it looks like he might want to try and go back in for a kill here. Blinks, or Ping's coming on out on the map. Exist could potentially, deny coming out last second. Arteezy really wanted it, and they're able to get the kill. What a turnaround. That was exceptionally well done. Unfortunately, Arteezy getting a little bit too greedy there. Laguna Blade comes on out as well. Epicenter down one more time. Swindle Melons might end up going down here, staying alive at the last second. Bloodseeker coming on in and killing people wherever at all possible. Swindle ends up staying alive. Man, oh man, that was exceptionally well done. Now we've got Omega Poner now who's going to get chased on down as well. Dazzle is up in the air, isn't going to be able to stun him, unfortunately, and Exist is coming after him, and he is super dead. Realizes that now at this point, and that is a kill. Very, very well done. 5-1. The Beastmaster did end up going down. And let's take a look at that fight recap. Only catching the end of it, that Rubick ended up going down, but really, really starting to swing into the favor of the Dire. And it all started with that pickoff at the Sand King. If you get that one, you realize that you're going to be able to fight more efficiently going forward. You're going to be able to start taking a sort of more greedy engagement. And then the backside, the real thing that I think pretty much screwed over the Radiant a little bit was that wanted to go for that last hit on the tower, but unfortunately, with all of the other heroes over there, he didn't anticipate the Queen of Pain being able to come in. Had he been able to get out of there, or had the Queen of Pain not shown up, there wouldn't have been enough burst damage to take him out before he could have TP'd. But unfortunately, the Bloodseeker was able to get on in there, get the kill on the tower, deny on the tower, excuse me, and then afterwards, able to kill him afterwards as well. So very, very well done. That was pretty awesome. Smoke coming on out. This is going to be to try and see if they can sort of turn the tide a little bit here. Honestly, they need to get more than a support with this. They need to be able to make something else happen. Silver Edge as well as an Aghanim Scepter on the Queen of Pain. Yeah, this is looking very, very rough. The Beastmaster already has Necronomicon. Looks like they're going to be able to kill this Beastmaster here. Shallow Grave coming out last second. Doesn't have a TP. Laguna Blade out as well. He's going to be able to catch out this Dazzle, I do believe. But now the Rupture coming on down as well as everything else. The Sonic Wave killing the Anti-Mage yet again. Look at that pure damage, baby. Oh my god, Dust coming out afterwards. Wants to kill the Lina here. Isn't going to be able to do it. But man, oh man, was that exceptionally well done or what? Really, really nicely done. Offensive GG, always a good thing. And it looks like they might end up trying to go and take Roshan at this time. in 15 minutes. All right. Arteezy calling it out. He's like Babe Ruth pointing to the sky with his future home run here. All right, this is looking pretty good. Pretty good, but a little bit of casual flame is always pretty solid. Cool. We've got Demon now with Epicenter if he so desires to use it, but might end up getting a little bit spotted out here. Really does not want to get gone on by Swindle here. He's probably freaking dead. Blink Dagger last second, very well done. Unfortunately, wasn't quite able to catch that. Bloodseeker picks up the Aegis as well. All right. We'll see how this ends up going. He's trying really hard. Always good. We were able to see a little bit of a clockwork pushing on up this top lane as well. Dazzle was able to take out the mid tower to deny out a little bit of extra EXP. We have, he is in a little bit of a spot of trouble. Look how low he is. Oh my god, he almost freaking died there. That's the thing, the blink can get countered pretty hard by that. He did have true sight of him, so unfortunately they weren't quite able to get the kill there. Needed to create a little bit of extra space there. Let's see, Necronomicon here as well is going to end up catching this Rubick here. Glimmer Cape out though to save his life. Roar goes out onto the Lina. This might end up being a return kill here. Sonic Wave out one time. She's not even going to be able to use Laguna Blade. Rubick's going to go down here as well. We do have the Anti-Mage. He's just going to try and continue to farm with five heroes here from the Radiant. Excuse me, Dire. Really don't want to get in the middle of all of this. And Exist is going to be able to steal his stacks as well. He's said, screw it. I'm going off to the jungle. I don't want any more of your garbage. I'm just going to go farm. That is who I am. I am farming. Does have Vlads at this point, so should be able to continue to take on down creep waves really effectively. Oh my god, Tavo's going down. We knew you. You were so young. Oh god, and they're going to be able to take down this tier 2 here as well. Probably can push on in for more if they so desire to. Anti-Mage is going to be trying to cut the creep wave here, so really, really solid there. It's something that's necessary. And I think that they, despite that, though, they're going to be able to continue to push on down into this base here. Really not exactly where they want to be at this point. More Fade Bolts coming on out. It's not going to be enough. They are at least going to lose a Rax off of this. Epicenter's pretty good, but nobody's going to end up dying off the back of it. Do as well pop the dust there. We got Arteezy going on in. Might be able to take out this this Bloodseeker if he's not careful. Does have Midas up as well, and the only other problem is that he's about to have BKB as well as still has Aegis. So they can go back in at any given point in time if they want to. We're able to save the Rax off the back of that, so that's pretty solid. Oh god, that is a dead Anti-Mage, y'all. Lesh ends up getting the last hit on him. They're going to be able to push on down this. GG ends up getting called. We'll see if this is for realsies or not. Probably is. Exist getting the Shallow Grave, still has Aegis though, and now he's getting heal backed up on the back of it as well. The Rubick was able to sail Blood Rage as well. So looks like the Radiant are still holding. They're still being able to make sure that, you know, nobody's gonna push on up this creep wave. They got decent amount of wave clear as well. Bloodseeker has BKB now. Anti-Mage is gonna be back up in 30. This is getting a little bit testy. Aegis reclaimed at 2 minutes as well. He probably just wants to run on in and potentially sacrifice himself here. Do still have Laguna Blade, Burrow Strike down. Oh god, able to stay alive again. The Shallow Graves are really, really solid here. Off the back of it, we're also going to be saying a Glimmer Cape just to keep him alive that much longer. And we'll see if they end up trying to rotate down onto the bot rune. They certainly could. Beastmaster's been able to pick up Necronomicons as well as a smoke, several Bloodstone charges on the Lesh. We've got the Beastmaster who went on back to base now also. Queen of Pain, Ags, as well as an Urn. We've got the Dazzle as well, who's been able to pick up that Glimmer Cape, working on a Force next. And the Silver Edge on Exist is really going to make a huge difference. You've got several, well, actually, you've only got really one hero that really is going to benefit from it, and that's the Anti-Mage with the Spell Shield. But I think that it's important. Like, if you're going to be, this really messes him up as you get towards the later stages of this game. Roche isn't going to be back up for a little while, but is going to just try and sit on up here, waiting for somebody to try and take these, but... Ping's coming on out. I think he's not gonna find anybody here, honestly. Arteezy does spot people coming on in again. We do have the Lina over here. They might try and see if they can make a gank happen. Is gonna be able to catch this Dazzle, but with Swindle coming on in, this is where things get a little bit scary. Making stuff happen. Blinks away though, doesn't want anything to do with this. Oh my god, he's stuck in the trees. He's gonna end up going down here, waiting for the Split Earth as well. Oh, the disaster. Oh my goodness. All right, yeah, this is a little bit of a rough game here right now for the Radiant team. Let's take a look at team net worth at this point. Working up to a 20,000 gold lead as well, about a 12,000 EXP lead as well. Disconnects from the game. Not sure if he's going to be coming on back into this at this point in time or not. Might be, might not. You never know. Okay, looks like they're going to end up calling GG here. So, and a little bit of an unfortunate end to the game, but you know what? These things happen throughout the course of a Dota 2 game, and looks like they're going to get one last kill on the Lina for good measure. Might opt to play it out. Nope, all right. Well, thank you guys for watching. You can catch me out at youtube.com/lyricalgangster, twitch.tv/lyricalgangster, twitter.com/lyricalgangster, and for Twitter and Twitch, switch the E with a 3, you'll find me. Thanks, guys, for watching. I'll be around for the next one, which should probably be popping off relatively shortly. See y'all later.